I'm doing a David's tea.
I know, thing. I see that. Are you looking for an endorsement deal?
I met a girl down at, a little shout out to the manager at David's Tea.
Where, which location?
Just down here on Spring Garden. Her name is Leslie. She's a doll. Yeah, she always tries to give me free tea, but...
You won't pay. You don't want any free rides.
Totally want to pay. No free rides.
Ladies and gentlemen, Joel Thomas Hynes. I feel like I should... You're like, do you do interviews? Are you elusive? I mean, what's the deal? What's your story?
I was talking to, somebody about that recently. 10 years ago, I gave so many interviews, and I just spilled my guts all over... Every microphone that
you were spent.
I kind of shot myself in the foot in some ways, being too open personally and all that. And then I sort of pulled back. And then when you pull back, it's not like Hollywood or anything where they come beating your door down. They just say, "Oh, he won't do an interview," but I do.
Oh well, that's good, and I'm glad, because I want to talk to you about this film, which. Just the trailer alone is bananas. I'm serious. It's beautifully shot, first of all.
It looks beautiful. DOP is first-time feature. Scott McClone, Newfoundland boy. Good, tight friends with the director. I think they had worked on another shorter project before that. And they had a real good rapport, and they each knew exactly what the other wanted. So, I mean, I always think... If you got a really, really good DOP who's on your page, half your job is done as a director.
There you have it. Well, here's the other side of that. You write this. You want to make it beautiful when it comes out. You want it to be your vision. Is it your vision? Is it how you saw it when you wrote it?
This was a little different of a project for me. It is based on one of my books. So,
it's a combo, though, right, of stories?
Yeah, there's a couple of stories. There's a bit of a storyline plucked out of another book of mine, but the fundaments of the story itself is based on a book called Say Nothing, Saw Wood, which is based on an old, old murder from my hometown. And I had performed the role of Jude years ago on stage, and then my son played it in the movie.
So we made
the character much younger in the movie than he, and the story is told differently, okay. Much differently. The perspective is completely askew. In the movie, it's one summer in this boy's life, all progressing towards the main event. In the book, it's the guy looking back on his life,
okay.
And going back through his upbringing, and it's years after,
okay.
You know, so it's a different perspective.
There's so many questions about this movie, but let's just start with the actual chemistry between, and the brilliant acting of your son. I mean...
Yeah, he's great. He is totally great.
People says... You don't go to church because you're a witch or something.
A witch? I suppose that's true some days. I never had much notion for church and prayers and the like. And then after my little girl died, I suppose I'd even less.
What happened to her? Maybe a troll got her.
A troll? I should hope not. Why? Do you see many trolls around here, Jude?
I don't know. Maybe.
Well, no troll got my little girl, I can tell you that much. Trolls got no appetite for good children. You know, children that does what they're told.
I heard you can pay them off with gold.
You could pay me off with gold if you got it. That way maybe I won't make soup out of you.
Oh, that wasn't too bad, eh?
Clubs.
He's been around sets. I mean, we like to joke. His mom did her first feature called The Bread Maker while he was in utero.
Okay. So that's it.
She was pregnant with him, so he's been on camera since he was in utero. And he was in my Down to the Dirt, that feature. He played a young me. His mom is Sherry White.
Yes.
She did Cracky. He did a scene in that. He's just been around it, and he's grown up around all of us. You know, seeing people he knows on television and the movies and putting out books and music and all this stuff.
Right.
And it just seems like that's life to him.
Right.
And once we got on board with casting him, because me and his mama were very resistant.
Heavy stuff.
Yeah, we were really resistant to casting him because he was 11 at the time,
right.
Turned 12 during the shooting, playing a 13-year-old. And it was a wild organic shoot, and everybody sort of got into character, you know?
Yeah.
And it was very dark. Me and him play on screen dad and boy.
Right.
And we had a very, very dark dynamic.
Yes.
And I played his very violent, abusive
father. Not at all
father.
True to life, which is, how does that turn, how does that, I mean, how does it come, you know what I mean? I can't imagine it.
You know what?
I can't imagine it.
Me and him just went for it.
Yeah.
And we worked it out, and we blocked it, just like a couple of professionals.
Yeah.
And then we went for it, and when they would call cut, we would just go and kind of laugh it off.
Well, that's what I heard about him. He's good at snapping out of the
moment. Oh, yeah, he is.
So some people carry it around.
We know it's so ridiculously removed from our actual relationship. But I think it really kind of was upsetting to a lot of the crew and people like that.
Right.
Me and him kind of shrugged it off.
Right.
We were fine.
He tells so much with his eyes, though, eh, Joel?
Like, yeah, he does, yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
What a gift.
He's very photogenic and knows what he's at. I've seen him. He just did Night at the Museum 3, you know.
That's huge.
That's a huge, like, multi-million dollar studio, big studio movie. And I'm there on set as his chaperone. And I'm hearing him.
You're a stage dad.
Yeah. I'm hearing him working things out with the directors and the producers, and they're really leaning in, listening, and he's having these kind of pseudo-philosophical conversations, and they're taking it on, incorporating his ideas into this big movie, and I'm thinking, well, wow. And
then it's all ahead of him.
Yeah, and then you're, on the other hand, you know, you can see that side of him, but on the other hand, you get a call home from school that he was caught sitting up on top of the bathroom stalls, squawking, perched like some kind of beast,
right?
So you...
He's a kid.
Yeah, balancing the two.
And now, was there any hesitation with you and Sherry to say, you know what, maybe don't act at all, steer clear of it?
No.
Never, ever that.
No. Listen, he gets so many auditions and he goes out, he's turned down some roles that I would kill for,
true.
I swear.
Yeah.
Well, I wouldn't kill, but... We don't push it on them.
No.
We don't say, this is who you are, this is what you have to do. We find some way to nurture him along. He's got an agent. He's got all that stuff. An agent who knows what he's looking for.
Right.
We're interested in, these days, we're interested in, for example, feature films. We don't want him doing a regular thing on TV or anything. So we're trying to find a balance.
Right.
But if, you know what? He comes to be 16, 17, 18, doesn't want to do it. It's of no harm to his life to have that stability during his teenage years.
Right.
That's the way we look
Great
at it.
Great experiences,
maybe
too.
Maybe he'll not want anything to do with any of that. Maybe he'll go direct or something, you know?
Who well, he's knows? Learning it now. Yeah. Okay, let's talk about your acting. First of all, I want to go back, if I could, to Doyle, because I always like to link everything back to Republic of Doyle. And how was that for you? Because everybody has their different take on it, but you're sort of dropping into a family there, and I know you know a lot of them,
yeah.
But that's a real unit. How was that for you?
Doyle is very technically challenging show to do.
Is that true?
Oh my God. Every time I'm on that show, I get into a big old fist fight with somebody, or cut somebody's throat, or shoot at somebody, or jump out of the way of something coming at me really fast.
Right.
And, you know...
Come
I'm not one for. I'm never jealous of other artists. Maybe I was in my younger days or something, but I've so outgrown that. But after my first season on Doyle, when I saw how much fun Hako has every day, just going to work,
right?
I was really happy to be on that show, actually.
Right.
Yeah.
And you played a very dark character.
Yeah. And then it switches. He's got a bit of buffoonery to him.
Yes.
Yeah.
You were claustrophobic. We learned that.
Yeah.
So now let me ask you this, because we've got Cast No Shadow. And
I will say about when you say about I play a really dark character on Doyle, you know, for years I've been playing outcasts or bad guy roles or something like that, right? But they always had some kind of back door of where an audience can step back from my characters and not take it that seriously. Oh, maybe he's just messed up.
Right.
Or there's a little bit of that buffoonery thing going on. But with Cast No Shadow, there is no, he's a relentlessly dark character, and I really, really wanted to play this role for a long, long time.
Is that true?
Yeah. So there's no back door, there's no...
redeeming quality, nothing.
There is redeeming qualities, but as they exist within an indie drama. So not to sound pretentious, but it's for... his redeeming qualities can be uncovered by a thinking audience.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
It's there in the writing, it's there in the performance, but it can easily be overlooked through his actions.
Right.
I mean, if you sat back and analyzed things, you'd say, oh, that's why he is this way, but the story clips along.
Right.
So we're hoping it's one of those sleepers that you want to see again.
Right.
Yeah.
Where I wanted to go from that was, so Cast No Shadow to Relative Happiness. Hey, there's a switch for you. Now, how was that? Like, it's a rom-com. There's no way to say it other than that. Good times?
Yeah, I had a good time. I stayed down in Hubbard's for a few weeks.
Yeah.
I guess, you know, I play a ruffian in that, but more of comic relief. And I got to work with Susan Kent. Me and Susan played on-screen boyfriend and girlfriend in a series that we did 10 years ago called Hatching, Matching, and Dispatching. So we really, other than a couple of events or something, we really hadn't worked together for all that time.
Okay.
And I hadn't seen her in a while. I mean, we slipped right back into our friendship immediately. But
she's a riot.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
It's great working with Susan, because there's just so much trust there. And when you can trust that when you're on camera and you might spin off somewhere and that other actor that you're working with will totally get on board with that, that's always a really, really good experience, right?
Yeah.
So
that's where I guess her improv comes in.
Oh, yeah, right? We got a real good dynamic, I always found.
Yeah.
And, you know, yeah, Road of Happiness was nice and light, fun, met a lot of good people.
Where did you do that, before or after Cast No Shadow?
I think it was afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it was nice. A nice...
Yeah.
What are you at now? What are you doing?
Right these days?
Yeah, because you always have something on the go, right?
I just put out an album.
Okay.
Yeah. A live EP. So I'm working on an album.
Nice.
And I'm in the writer's lab at the Canadian Film Centre.
And what does that mean?
I'm a screenwriter in residence at the CFC in Toronto. And it's a 6-month, very intensive program.
Writing with other people, or?
Working on a couple of features.
Okay.
I got a feature in development with a Halifax producer named Alan Collins, who I got pretty tight with on Relative Happiness. He was one of the producers. I hooked in with him and Mark Allman.
Okay.
He produced Blackbird. So I'm got a new feature in development, going to camera.
Wow.
When the weather breaks in the spring.
So you wrote that? Are you in it as well, or?
I wrote it, and I can only say I'll be a key player in the production of it.
Okay. Can you give me a title?
That's called Dry Swallow. Yeah. And that's what I'm at these days.
Very good. So, but there's never a dull moment.
Yeah, I have lots of dull moments.
Come on. And I wanted to say, everybody was thrilled with your appearance here.
I know.
Hey, you were like, here, here. here. You weren't supposed to be here.
I know.
Are you a fly-by-the-seat of your pants kind of guy? Is that what it is? Or?
Well, I was just up at the Toronto Film Festival, and I was so burned out from that scene that I couldn't...
This is a different vibe.
I know.
Though,
I maintained the best swag bag I ever got was at Atlantic Film Festival in 2008.
Okay.
But,
what was in it?
What was in it? I'll tell you. A great big rum cake.
Okay.
Right?
Nice.
Two bags of coffee, local coffee, like Just Us or something was just getting on the go.
Right.
A whole bunch of chocolate. A great big bag of stuff. I was so impressed with the swag bag, yeah.
Nice.
So we did.
And so you come back for the goods.
I came back looking for my swag bag, yeah.